Hello, everyone. I hope you are doing well. It's time for the monthly Q&A. I have received some interesting questions this month. However, a couple of questions need a more detailed explanation. Therefore, I prefer to keep them for future videos. I recommend you watch the entire video if you have the time. Or else, feel free to use the timestamps to skip over to the questions that interest you. Before we take a quick look at the question, allow me apologize in advance for butchering any names. Today's question include, first, Fret Talks, Eight Immortals. Second, Nominal, One, Weather Conditions and Zhanzhuang. Third, from Nominal, Other Sides While Walking in Nature. Question number 4, Healthy Movement Concepts, Die Da Jiu. Question number 5, from SI. First, Theory Behind Die Da Jiu Formulas. Question number 6, from SI. Meditation for Internal Martial Artist. Question number 7, from SI. Tai Chi Sword Mythology. Question number 8, from SI. Light Body Arts. Question number 10 from Ning Run, Tai Chi and Qigong Recommendations. Question number 12 from Ian Eaton, Tai Chi and Xiu Dao. Question number 12 from Angel Marco Granica Garcia, Tai Chi and Fighting Strategy. Question number 13 from Ernesto Pong, Variations of Yang Style Tai Chi. Question number 14 from Ernesto Pong, General Qi Jiguang's Influence on Martial Arts. Question number 15 from Bosatu Nai, Spanish Tai Chi Book by Ferran Tarango. Question number 16 from Maduro Holdings, Xing Yi and Yi Jingjing. Question number 17 from Jesse G. Lim, Xing Yi and Seven Stars. Question number 18 from Blazing 50, Xing Yi and Elbow Position. Question number 19 from Rusty Red Nail X, Xing Yi, Bagua and Qi in Lower Abdomen. So, without any further ado, let's get started. First, Frederick Talks writes, Eight Immortals would be a great subject for future video. You should add it to the long list. Thank you, Fred. It's a good suggestion. So I'd like to briefly introduce the Eight Immortals since it is related to some Taoist figures. There are different versions of the Eight Immortals containing different names. However, the latest version of the most widely accepted version of Ba Xian includes Tie Guai Li, Han Zhong Li, Lui Dongbin, Zhang Guo Lao, He Xian Gu, Cao Guo Jiu, Han Xiangzi, and Lan Cai He. This version was first mentioned in a novel Dong You Ji or Eastern Journey by Wu Yuan Tai about 350 years ago during the Ming Dynasty. Those eight figures were real people from different periods in Chinese history. They represent eight groups of people according to ancient Chinese social standards. Male, female, old, young, rich, poor, upper class, and lower class. According to the novel, each of them underwent the process of becoming an immortal through experiencing different life challenges. Also, since they are immortals, each of them uses a kind of magical utensil to exercise their magical powers. The Eight Immortals are part of religious Taoist figures and worshipped in Taoist temples. Fred, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next one. Nomino asks, now in summers, it's pleasant to be outside. We can read and hear now and then that one should not do 站桩 outside if there's wind or rain, even if it's warm and one does not feel cold or distracted at all. Is there a TCM principle behind this? Thank you, Nomino. Well, short answer, it depends. Let me explain. If you practice 站桩for energy cultivation such as Qigong, then you should avoid the practice during strong winds and rainfall. Such weather conditions will only distract you from the practice. However, if you practice 站桩for martial arts, then wind or rain will not be an issue at all. When I was a child, I almost exclusively practiced martial art outside. Come rain, come shine. No pun intended, since that was the living condition. However, when I practiced Qigong and meditation, most of the time it was inside. That was based on practical purposes, not at all on tradition. Nomino, I hope I have answered your question. Let's look at the next question, also from Nomino. Nomino asks, maybe for the next Q&A, do you have any recommendations regarding walking in the woods for hours? Are there practice approaches that can be done while walking up and down mountains on passes? What I often do is to gather saliva while walking, put the tip of the tongue on the palate, and swallow consciously the saliva. I found it refreshing in a different way than drinking water. I also walk sometimes with the arms and if resting on a table. I also find that refreshing, as if it does something to the energy of the body. Thank you again, Nomino. I'm sorry I'm not in a position to answer the first question, as I have not had the chance to practice this exercise. I guess it is an excellent way to relax your mind and refresh your energy. Nowadays, it is actually a luxury to spend time walking in the woods, so you should make the most of it. And for the second part, well, that can be perceived as the walking Qigong exercise. What you are doing based on your description is great. Nomino, sorry for the limited answer to your question, but I hope that helps. Let's look at the next one. Next question is from Healthy Movement Concepts asks, I used Dear Dajiu sometimes, but wonder if it is really doing anything. Can you talk about it a little bit? Thank you. Thank you, Healthy Movement Concepts. Dear Dajiu is the traditional Chinese medicine product used to treat injuries. Very often, people add different ingredients into alcohol, and the medical components in those ingredients can be extracted into alcohol. Applying this alcohol tincture to the affected area of the body is the main method of using it. Traditionally, there are two different types of Dia Dajiu for internal or external usage. Also, some type of Dia Dajiu can be used for both internal and external purposes. However, you have to be careful because many Dia Dajiu are not fit for ingestion. So, do not drink those if you are not absolutely sure of the ingredients. They are pretty safe and effective when used externally. There is no standard Dia Dajiu formula. Different people have their own formulas. The healing effect of Dia Dajiu to physical injury can be very obvious. At the very least, it can accelerate the healing process. However, please do not use Dia Dajiu for practicing iron palm. Like I have mentioned in prior Q&A, I do not recommend anyone practice iron palm in modern times. Hope that answers your question, Healthy Movement Concepts. Let's look at the next one. As I ask 5 questions, let me answer them one by one. For the next Q&A topic, first, what is the theory behind the Dia Dajiu formulas? Each Kung Fu style has their own formulas. What are they trying to achieve within the formula. I'm aware some schools advocate putting green mug beans in bean bags and heating it. From what I understand, green mug beans has a cooling effect. Are the Dia Da Jiu formula trying to cool the skin, or are they trying to heat up, or something else? Like I mentioned in my answer to the previous question, Dia Da Jiu is only to help the body to recovery. There are different ingredients used for different formulas, but basically they follow the same principle of stimulating the blood circulation and the pain reduction. Ice's second question, should Tai Chi Ba Gua Xing Yi practitioners practice meditation? Is there any advantages for it? Well, it depends on individual choice. Meditation only provides indirect benefits, for instance, increasing calmness of the mind, improved sensitivity of the body to energy, improved energy flow in the body to internal martial artist. I said third question. I heard some old Tai Chi swords are made with a special formulation of metals to help conduct qi. Is there any truth to it? Well, those are just some of the legendary stories of martial arts. Metal in the sword are simply external elements that cannot provide any internal benefit. I said fourth question. Do you know anything about light body arts? When I say light, I mean so in the form of weight, not light as in flashlight energy. I will talk about it in a future video. Hope that answers the question. I say, let's move on to the next one. Ning Ryu asks four questions and I would like to answer them one by one. I have been practicing the five Qigong exercises that you have presented on this channel, and I feel they are the strongest Qigong I have ever experienced. Not to say that I have practiced many other forms, only a few. Nonetheless, I have made them part of my regular practice, so I hope it is okay to ask a few questions about this style. First, does this form have a name? Ning Ryu is asking with the reference to my Qigong series posted during the early stage of the pandemic in 2020. I chose some movement from different type of Qigong that I practiced before, so there is no official name for it. Since there is no name yet, we just can give it one. We can call it Energy Strengthening Qigong, since it was my objective to create a small routine to strengthen overall energy level during the pandemic. Also, these movements can invigorate your energy as well. With the minimum investment of time, people can experience energy sensitivity very well. Ninrun's second question. Are there more than the five exercises you have shown so far? If you, would you consider to show the rest? Sorry, maybe they are for inner students. Yes, there are more exercises, but for basic energy strengthening purposes, those five should be sufficient for now. Of course, the next step would be some exercises that lead the energy further inward. I may spend some time demonstrating further exercises in the future. Ning Ryu's third question. I have been doing all five exercises in one practice for about 20 to 30 minutes. Is okay or correct or incorrect? If so, is it correct to bring the hands to the middle burner between each exercise, or should I wait until the very end? Well, if you continuously practice those movements, then it is unnecessary to work on the closing movement each time. You can just follow the sequence and then practice the closing movement in the end and stay in the last posture for a longer time. Ning Ryu's fourth question. After the practice, I have been resuming with Tai Chi Yang form for about 20 minutes. Is this okay, or do you recommend not to do this? Well, You should practice Tai Chi first, then practice Qigong in the end. You will achieve more benefits by doing so. In the internal styles, you should always follow the sequence of physical to energetic. And Ninrin, I hope I have answered your questions. If my guess is right, you are from Japan. Unto you. I'm very happy to see that you practice Tai Chi, Qigong, and the Japanese martial arts as well. Ian Eaton wrote a great comment. He said, referring to your concept of fire in the video, my interest is in applying the fire to a movement. So when practicing Tai Chi, there are any number of dynamic movements that could be practiced. For example, a punch, if practiced slowly, is aimed at improving the technique, not the speed or the power. Therefore, focusing the mind to visualize the correct action during and covering the time the action takes to unfold can be applying fire. The obvious result would be that in doing so, I would not be doing Xiu Dao. This leads to the question of how would the Tai Chi and the Xiu Dao interact? Or am I confusing apples and pears? Cheers from Ian on the west coast of Australia. Thank you for your question, Ian. If you practice Tai Chi as a martial art, then it has nothing to do with Xiu Dao, since Xiu Dao has a clear scope of practice. However, if you practice Tai Chi for health, then you can apply some Xiu Dao concept into Tai Chi, which is great. Personally, I prefer to practice Tai Chi as the martial art and Xiu Dao for health. I like to keep each practice separate with its own purpose. I suggest you try to apply some Xiu Dao concept in your Tai Chi practice to enhance your sensitivity to energy during Tai Chi practice. I will talk more about this in the future. Hope that answers your question, Ian. Let's look at the next one. Angel Mario Janica Garcia asks, for Q&A, I would love to know how exactly should fight a Tai Chi Chen style practitioner. In which stance, chasing the parry or being the first to hit, focusing in grappling with some strikes like old judo or vice versa. Things like that, always curious about it. Thank you for your videos, love all the theory. Angel, thank you for the question. Well, I don't think there's the fixed rule for this, since you are talking about applying a martial practice in a self-defense situation. In any self-defense situation, you shouldn't depend on predetermined techniques. Instead, martial movements and techniques should be applied naturally. Part of a martial art practice is to train the subconscious mind so that you can apply martial art practice simultaneously. So, any stance, parry, techniques, or whatever necessary and effective can and should be used in a self-defense situation. But if I have to state the general Tai Chi approach, it would be to intercept the opponent's attack and redirect it back to them, no matter what stance or angle. I hope I have answered your question, Angel. Let's look at the next question. Ernesto Pong asks, dear Yang Laoshi, thank you for this clear and detailed video on Tai Chi. For the next Q&A, I would like to ask the following two questions. First, could you explain the differences among Yang Lu Chan, Yang Ban Hou, Yang Shao Hou, and Yang Sheng Fu styles? Second, could you talk about the influence of General Qi Ji Guang on the Chinese internal martial arts? Thank you, Ernesto. To your first question about variations in Yang style Tai Chi, I can only give a very brief answer in this video since I need a much longer video to do it justice. Basically, there are three generations of Yang style Tai Chi. Before going further, Let me give you all a quick breakdown of the three generations. Yang Luchan was the founder of Yang style Tai Chi. Yang Banhou was the son of Yang Luchan, thus the second generation of Yang style Tai Chi. Yang Shaohou and Yang Shengfu were the third generation of Yang style Tai Chi. Now, without naming any names, I have to say that there are some people who claim that their form is the Yang Luchan form. But looking at all the evidence, I found it really hard, if not impossible, to agree with this claim. We all know that Yang Luchan studied Chen style Tai Chi, so his Tai Chi should look similar to Chen style Tai Chi. Unfortunately, I have not yet seen such a demonstration from any Yang Luchan form practitioner. Sometimes, people try to figure out Yang Luchan form by observing Yang Banhou's form with the assumption that Yang Banhou, being Yang Luchan's son, would have preserved the practice taught by his father. Well, that is not true either. Yang Banhou also studied with Wu Yuxiang, the founder of Wu Hao style Tai Chi. As for Yang Shengfu, he changed the form even more. In my opinion, all of their practice are equally good. I'm aware that quite a few people criticize Yang Shengfu's form, but I found his form to be in the same league as the others. Now, let's talk about your second question regarding General Qi Jiguang and his contribution. I have briefly introduced Qi Jiguang in some prior videos. Basically, he was one of the important figures in Chinese military history who systematically developed Chinese military training in the 16th century. His military training method was adopted by later generations in developing martial art training. Please keep in mind that military training and martial art training are two different things. Military training focuses more on army formation, while martial art training focuses more on individual training. There is some overlap with each other, but they focus on different aspects in training. Qi Jiguang did not develop martial art training enough, but contributed greatly to military training. It was actually the later generations who adopted his military training methods and applied them in martial art training. Hope that answers your question, Ernesto. Let's look at the next question. Bosatu Nai asks, I read in Span Tai Chi Chuan book by Ferran Tarango, president of the National Tai Chi Chuan Association of Spain, the mystical aspect of Tai Chi Chuan is an authentic work of internal alchemy. That work consists of various phrases resumed in first learn to generate energy in the Tan Tian, second learn to use and manipulate the energy, driving it down and up through the light rain, third one of the stage of the mystical development of Tai Chi would consist in suppressing the mental principle through making the intention effect the act, completing the Tai Chi Chuan or mystical union of man with the cosmos. Could you clarify these mystical works? Bosatu Nai, thank you for your question. I don't think I understand his writing. I think it is the New Age perception of Tai Chi. It may just to be his personal experience. Originally, Tai Chi was created for self-defense and not practiced as internal alchemy. Internal alchemy or Xiudao practice is a specific practice system which applies a static approach to energy refinement. I have some videos introducing Xiu Dao in my channel. Please have a look and you will know the differences between Tai Chi and Xiu Dao. Furthermore, you can use Tai Chi movement as a medium to practice energy strengthening exercise. But the Tai Chi movement alone without following original Tai Chi principles will not be considered Tai Chi anymore. A byproduct cannot replace the main product. Maduro Holdings asks, is Yi Jin Jing a good substitute for traditional Xingyi exercise such as dragon turning head, pick up moon from beneath the sea, and ball waves head and lion play with ball? I have been doing those for years but feel something is missing from my Nei Gong or exercise practice. My teacher says the elements are enough, but if they are enough, why include those exercises set in the first place? Thank you for the question. Yi Jin Jing or change the tandem practice is nowadays a part of Shaolin practice. Some experts believe that Yi Jin Jing was originally developed in Taoist practice. Yi Jin Jing text clearly used many Taoist terms. By adding Buddha's concept into Taoist practice, this practice becomes very unique. I agree with this research. For your second question regarding some exercises used to practice Nei Gong, the form such as dragon turning head, pick up moon from the bottom of the sea, and so on, are old exercises practiced by some Hebei-style Xingyi practitioners, such as Zhang Zhaodong. When Zhang Zhaodong was old, he practiced this form and taught it to his students as well. Zhang used this practice for health, not at all for martial application. So, as for Nei Gong practice, Yi Jin Jing is not a substitute for those exercises. Furthermore, even those exercises are not enough for developing internal strength for self-defense. Zhang Zhaodong himself clearly said that those practices were for health, not directly aimed at martial application. Hope that answers the question, Maduro Holdings. Let's look at the next question. Jesse Gillen asks, thank you for doing these videos. I greatly enjoyed your content. I practice the Hebei Xingyi Quan and I would like to ask if during your next Q&A you would discuss the 7 stars and if there are exercises for including them in Xingyi practice. Thank you again. Thank you for the question, Jesse. 7 stars or Qi Xing has 2 versions. The first version indicates 7 places in the body that can be used for self-defense. Those are head, shoulder, elbow, hand, hip, knee, and feet. The second version indicates 7 forces in different directions. Those are forward, backward, upward, downward, left, right, and center. As for the practice, of course, there are many different types of practice for each star or area, which is beyond the scope of this video. I will talk about it in a future video. Hope that answers your question, Jesse. Let's look at the next question. Blazing 50 asks, thank you for the video. In one of your videos, you said the knee extend outward. Does this apply to the elbows as well? Also, I was watching a video of a Xingyi guy in China saying the elbows don't leave the flanks. Can be clarified this please, if possible? I would really appreciate it. Thanks. Thank you for the question, Blazing 50. Well, the idea of elbows never leaving the flanks is a very common misperception caused by translation. It is just impossible to never let the elbows leave the flanks. Actually, in Chinese language, 肘不离肋, which translates to elbow do not leave the rib cage, can mean many things. For example, elbows have to be close to the rib cage so that the rib cage area can be protected. During formal practice, when the elbows get close to the elbow, rib cage, you will be naturally forced to move the body more. So, no matter what, 肘部离肋 does not mean that elbows should not leave the flanks. In the Chinese language, very often, many words are removed from a term to make it sound phonetically pleasant. So, the flanks should actually be written as the entire space in the vicinity of the rib cage, not just the physical rib cage. Blessing 50, I hope I have answered your question. Let's look at the final question for today. A rusty red nail X asks, I have been enjoying your video and found them very informative. My Bagua Xingyi teacher speaks very little English, so I hope you can answer my question. I'm very slim, but why practice my lower abdomen become full and round? My teachers say this is the qi, but is there an explanation for this phenomenon from a Western anatomical perspective? To which I initially responded, I do not see your abdomen and your practice, so no way to answer it for you, sorry. Then he wrote back, hi, thanks, fair point. Perhaps I should frame my question more generally. When the lower abdomen becomes full and round during practice, my teacher and the discussion in writing about internal styles explains this phenomenon as qi filling the dantian. Is there a way to understand this without reference to qi? For example, perhaps the relaxation and the turning of the waist encourage blood to the center, to the intestines or other organs. Do very much appreciate your clear and open communication of traditional Chinese martial arts theory, history, and practice. Thank you, a rusty red nail X, for the clarification. I think I understand your question better now. I have to be very straightforward that it has nothing to do with qi. After practice, the lower abdomen may become bigger. Actually, that is not a good result according to the internal styles. It is a very common misperception that people perceive a bigger abdomen to be full of qi. But think about this. Qi or energy is something which does not occupy space, but instead merges with space. So, having an abdomen full of qi does not mean that your stomach will expand. It may expand if your stomach is full of food or air, or in this case, if your upper abdomen pushes downward. Inside the upper and the lower abdomen, there are some organs. Pushing the upper abdomen downward causes the organs in the upper abdomen to move downward. As a result, the lower abdomen pushes outward and thus becomes bigger. So, I have to disagree with that claim. Then, I have answered your question. So, that brings us to the end of this month's Q&A. Thank you for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.